Hello and welcome to the Vitae 2021 3-minute thesis competition, sponsored by Taylor & Francis and with support from UKRI. Vitae has proudly hosted the competition since 2014, and this year the 6 finalists have been chosen from an outstanding 61 entries from Vitae member institutions around the UK. The 3-minute thesis challenges doctoral candidates to present a compelling spoken presentation of their research topic and its significance in just 3 minutes. Since 2014, the Vitae 3MT competition has resulted in over 10,000 researchers describing their approximately 80,000 word long theses in just 3 minutes, a feat that would normally take around 9 hours. Our 6 finalists are competing for 2 awards: the Judge's Choice winner, who will receive £3,000 from UKRI, and the People's Choice winner, who gets £1,000, with both awards to be spent on public engagement activities. And after the success and excitement of last year, we will be opening the voting after our finalists have presented, so that you, our viewers, can decide our winner. Both winners have a year to carry out their public engagement activity, and we will be encouraging them to think about their activities that not only help their own development as scientists, but also things that bring the wonder and importance of science to a diverse an audience as possible. Last year's People's Choice winner, Vinaya Srirangam Nadhamuni from Bart Cancer Institute, Queen Mary's University of London, used her prize money to break down language barriers to increase the uptake of cancer screening programs in underserved minority communities. Vinaya is doing this through the translation of awareness videos into Bengali and Urdu. Vinaya's amazing efforts to democratize access to science are truly inspirational. Not only that, but her research and related engagement work has had and continues to have a positive impact on people's lives. My own work in science communication also highlights the importance of language when trying to convey complex yet important science to an engaged yet not formally trained public. Be that language spoken, as in Vinaya's example, or nonverbal, we scientists must work harder to understand how a diverse public learn about and trust science, such that they may fully engage with and ultimately adopt some of the science-based policies that shape their everyday lives. The competition is a fantastic example of how to engage the public with research. It not only helps the candidates build key skills for their future careers, but it is also a great way for the wider public to understand the important role science and scientists play in society in their everyday lives.
They have had everything from job offers, invitations to speak at other events, a TED talk. It's unquantifiable, actually, the impact that 3MT has had on some of our finalists.
It's also been an excellent exercise in honing down exactly what I'm doing. Focus on why you love your research and why you, what you want to tell people, and why it's important for people to know this. I think that was the most helpful thing for me.
And now to introduce the judging panel, who will once again be chaired by Dr. Astrid Wissenberg, Chair of the Careers Research Advisory Centre and the Director of Research at the University of Exeter. And today Astrid is joined by Dr. Jamie Gallagher, a public engagement professional. Dr. Siobhan Neary, Associate Professor and Head of the International Centre for Guidance Studies at the University of Derby. Joya Wango, Non-Executive Director at the University of Nairobi. Dr. Paul Spencer, PGR Environment Development Manager at the University of Bristol. And finally, Caroline Sutton, Director of Open Research at Taylor & Francis. So what are the judging criteria? What are the judges looking for? The judging criteria is broken down into two main themes. The first reflecting comprehension and content. Here the judges are assessing how clearly the candidates describe the background to and significance of their research and their research strategy, findings and impact. The second criteria captures engagement and communication. Here the judges are assessing how clear the language is to a non-specialist audience, to what extent the slide enhances their presentation, and how enthusiasm is communicated by the presenter. Right, let's get on with the show. I'm delighted to introduce our first finalists, Theo Issit from the University of York, with their presentation, The Smell of Cells.
Sometimes I jump to conclusions. When I feel just a little bit sick, I might worry that it's some terrible incurable disease, or that that tickle on the back of my throat is COVID. But how do I know that the symptoms that I have after looking them up on the internet late at night are not in fact cancer or heart disease? Well, there's no better way to stop a disease than to catch it early. And that's why you might have a blood test, a lateral flow test, or even an MRI. But what if there was a way to check your health without the need of a needle, a swab to the back of the throat, or a very, very expensive machine? Well, the answer could be in your breath. You may have heard of people able to smell diseases such as Parkinson's or even dogs that can smell cancer. Well, it's these smells which are made up of a mixture of gases that provide us with a specific disease signature. These gases are released in their thousands in your breath, and they can give us information about what is happening in every cell of your body. But for many diseases, the gases and smells that are released are not yet known. And so we have to go right back to the level of the cell to know what to look for when your cells get sick. My PhD research looks at the gases released by cancer cells so that we can test the breath of patients to know what to look for signs of disease. In the body, it might go something like this. A cell gets sick from stress, maybe. It releases different smells and gases that then travel around the body and can ultimately be detected in the breath. I grow cancerous and non-cancerous cells, and I also stress them out by taking away their sugar or their oxygen. And I do that to model different diseases, such as a growing tumor. These cells are then placed in a special chamber so that I can sample the air above the cells to check for changes in the gases. And the really exciting news is that I've found some. And so I can confidently say that I can not only determine different sorts of cancer, but also different sources of stress, which I can apply to different diseases. This is really exciting news, and the next step is to test the breath of patients to see if the gases that we've identified are there. And then we can diagnose disease, not just in cells, but in patients too. With our ongoing research, we will link more gases released by cells to diseases so that we can make breath tests to provide fast, non-invasive diagnosis of cancer, COVID, or maybe even Parkinson's. This early diagnosis is absolutely key in the successful treatment, management, and controlling the spread of disease.
Thank you, Theo. Next up is Elena Dovchenko from Queen Mary's University of London with their presentation, Key to the Brain. Open your mind to drugs.
Key to the brain. Open your mind to drugs. I bet this phrase may sound a bit dodgy and unhealthy, but today I'm going to talk about the treatment of brain disorders. Stroke and dementia are 2 out of 10 main causes of death worldwide, and they're responsible for the death of about 8 million people a year. This is the population of a whole of Switzerland. Imagine the population of an entire country dies every year due to brain malfunctioning. But why is it so difficult to treat brain diseases? Because it's literally hard to get into someone's head. If you take a pill, or if a nurse injects the drug through the bloodstream, only a tiny percentage can actually reach the target. This happens because of the smart barrier that surrounds the brain, called the blood-brain barrier. It protects the brain like a wall that surrounds the city, but it also does not allow an entry of any drug, The idea of my PhD is pretty simple. If you have a wall with closed doors, find a key to open them so you can deliver a package with a medicine. We want to put a drug cargo inside a carrier and supply it with keys to open the doors to the brain. The solution to this big challenge can be found at the nanoscale, which means that the size of the carrier must be extremely small. Imagine that the drug carrier I've created is the size of my hand. In this case, the brain to which we want to deliver the drug must be the size of the Earth. Of course, the real human brain is only about 15 centimeters in diameter. And this makes the design of such a tiny carrier, a nanocarrier, a particularly sophisticated task. How would you make something you can't even see by your naked eye? This is where chemistry can help, and where my research comes in. To look at the nanocarriers, I have to use something more efficient than our eyes, for example, electron microscopy. At this stage, I've proposed a simple and effective synthetic methodology for creating nanocarriers. They can transfer a high amount of drug and release it on demand. The next step for me is to attach keys to the nanocarriers. A key is a biological molecule that the blood-brain barrier can recognize and allow the nanocarrier to enter the brain. An attachment of a key to the nanocarrier still remains a puzzle I'm trying to solve. But when achieved, we move one step further to unlock the diseased brain to the treatment. And of course, that's very motivating because the function of our brain makes all the difference in our quality of life.
Thank you, Elena. Next up is Mohamed Farouki from the University of Huddersfield with their presentation, An Exploration of the Factors Favouring Positive Educational Outcomes at GCSE of Male Pakistani Learners in a Northern Mill City.
So imagine the scenario. You are starting your first job as a teacher. You're excited by the prospect that you are now in a position to positively impact on the lives of young people. And then on your first day, you're given a class. And then you're told that this lot won't learn anything, that they're going to get grade U's at GCSE, and that your job is mainly to entertain them. Well, of course, I panicked because I realized I hadn't packed my red nose nor my curly wig that morning. And most definitely, I cannot juggle to save my life. But joking aside, education and teaching is a serious business, so much so that this experience led to my research. The class in question was a group of Pakistani students, and the idea that you could decide on their fate years before they sit any formal examination was beyond my understanding. Now, academic performance at GCSE for Pakistani students has had wide attention over the decades. Now, my research study will aim to explore more closely how in male Pakistani learners, in light of the national picture of poor educational performance, and despite the social, the challenging social and environmental factors, that a small but significant group do go on to succeed at GCSE and access further and higher education. Now, a lot of research has emerged looking at poor performance, and this is now very well documented. However, if we continue to look at poor performance, this may reinforce this negative stereotype. Now, my research, in contrast, aims to look at positive educational outcomes in Pakistani students whose family history stems from the Azad Kashmir region of Pakistan and where the majority are from the rural agricultural district of Mirpur. So, my research has three aims. Firstly, to identify and map out factors that contribute to positive educational outcomes of male Pakistani learners who have attended a non-selective inner city high school in the north of England. Secondly, to look at internal and external factors that impact positively on GCSE performance. And thirdly, to identify other wide attitudes and approaches to improving educational outcomes. Now, to determine this, the method used here is to tap into the lived experiences of these learners through a narrative storytelling approach. Now, this approach will hopefully provide a beginning, a middle and an end, and in so doing, map out the important experiences that have all come together to create a positive educational outcome. Now, importantly, to be able to shed an explanation on the successful may help policymakers shed light upon the unsuccessful, and in so doing, reverse the circumstances of the unsuccessful. As there is currently limited knowledge in this area, it is hoped that my study will shed important light on the factors leading to positive academic outcomes in the Pakistani community. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mohammed. Next up is Anna Pavlovich from Kingston University with their presentation, Pre-Stress Losses of Pre-Tensioned BFRP Reinforced Concrete Beams.
I'm Anna, and I love concrete. And this is a toy I used to play with as a child. What's the connection? We'll get there in a minute. But first, let's talk about concrete. Engineers like it so much, it's become the most used material in the world. We use it for anything, from plant pots to skyscrapers. But concrete suffers from corrosion. With time, the steel inside begins to rust. And if the damage isn't spotted in time, the structures may even collapse. This is why, in my PhD, I'm looking at another material that can be used to reinforce concrete structures. It is made by crushing and melting basalt, the most abundant volcanic rock on Earth. We call it basalt fiber reinforced polymer. Let's just call it rock bar for short. Rock bar is 3 times stronger and more than 3 times lighter than steel, and crucially, it doesn't rust. But it's too flexible, and as it bends, it creates cracks on the concrete surface. For a solution, let's look again at my giraffe. If the button on the toy is pressed, the giraffe is relaxed and flexible. If we release the button, this tightens the thread inside, compresses the giraffe, and makes it stiff. Surprisingly enough, the same principle applies to reinforced concrete. We can stretch the bar, pour concrete around it, wait for it to harden, and then release the bar. This compresses the concrete and makes it stiff. We call this pre-stressing, and we know that it will make concrete less prone to bending and cracking. But what we don't know is how stiff it will still be in 50 or 100 years. And this is exactly the question I'm working on in my PhD. To do this, I created a number of beams using this method I've just described. I recreated the conditions they will encounter in real life, and then I observed their behavior over long periods of time using sensors capable of detecting a contraction or expansion 100,000 times smaller than a single human hair. This allows me to understand in detail what is changing and why. Using all this information, I'm now developing mathematical models that will allow us to predict how this rock bar pre-stressed concrete will behave over its entire lifetime. To explain the underlying principles involved, I use the example of a toy. But of course, this is a very serious matter. I believe that replacing steel with rock bar will help engineers create more durable, rust-free concrete structures and thus make them less liable to collapse. And I'm working on it. Thank you.
Thank you, Anna. Next up is Mike Richardson from the University of Bath with their presentation, Seeing with the Tongue.
I want you to close your eyes and keep them closed. It's going to feel like a really long time, but I will tell you when to open them again. So just bear with me. But first, imagine never opening your eyes again. No more films. No driving, no seeing smiles. You can learn Braille and read, get a cane and a guide dog and walk. Identify your friends in the street, not by your face, but by a friendly, hey, it's Mike. Some lifestyle changes and you'll get by, succeed and thrive. But the experience of vision, the fluffiness of a cloud in the sky and the peculiar shape of your uncle's nose, it's gone, lost. Or is it? Your eyes detect patterns of light, which in turn create electrical impulses in your brain, and it's your brain that does the seeing. Now, open your eyes. The light and color and shadow that's all rushing in are all just electrical impulses as your neurons fire. But so is the sound of my voice and the feeling of your feet on the floor. The only thing that's different is that in your life, your brain has matched together one set of signals with one experience and another set of signals with another experience. Using technology, we can hack this process to provide information from one sense into another. In my PhD, I work with sensory substitution devices, machines that capture visual information with a camera and then convert that information into sound or touch. In particular, I work with a device called the brain port, so named as the inventor likened it as to a USB port into the brain, which for reference, it absolutely isn't. The brain port converts visual information into electrical stimulation on the surface of your tongue. If you were to hold your hand up to the camera, it would feel like a tiny electrical hand has been placed on the surface of your tongue. I'm testing how we interpret spatial information with this device, asking questions like, which way is up on the surface of your tongue? If a fat pigeon was to swoop down to steal your chips, should that appear at the tip or the back? And I'm using this information to create new software to help improve the spatial awareness of blind athletes and exercisers by reconnecting them to visual-like experiences programmed through the sensation of touch. While the experience of the fluffy cloud will never quite be the same as vision, there will be an experience of the cloud. We have reconnected the brain to visual information that would be otherwise lost. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. Finally, we have Manuela Kanagi from the University of Greenwich with their presentation, Houston, the Mosquito Has Landed.
Imagine you're on your dream holiday in that gorgeous tropical location. You're out having fun, enjoying yourself, when you start hearing a buzzing sound, and then zzz, a mosquito bites you. We can all agree that mosquitoes are extremely irritating, but not only that, they're also the world's deadliest animals, as they transmit diseases that cause the death of over 700,000 people per year. And malaria alone accounts for 2/3 of those deaths, the majority occurring in children under 5 years old, which means that every 2 minutes, a child dies because of malaria. For decades, malaria was controlled using chemicals that kill the mosquitoes, but now mosquitoes have become resistant to these chemicals. So as we can no longer rely on chemicals, we need to find new ways to control mosquitoes, and we need to do it urgently. An alternative idea is the use of traps that attract and catch mosquitoes. But to improve traps' efficiency, we need to better understand which properties are attractive to mosquitoes so that we can recreate the same properties on traps and drive mosquitoes towards them. And here is where my project comes in as I explored what drives mosquitoes to land on humans. In my study, I presented mosquitoes with different human properties that they normally use to find us, like our body odor or our temperature. I found that when these properties are presented together, they act in what's called a synergistic manner, meaning that the presence of one property enhances mosquitoes' response to other properties, which then leads to more mosquitoes in the trap. So I concluded that for traps to be more effective, they should present specific combinations of these properties. I also found other ways of reducing the cost of the trap while maintaining their performance. For example, I discovered that by hitting just half of the surface, the trap catches the same amount of mosquitoes as if it was fully heated. So clearly, less heat equals lower cost. Malaria, it's a devastating disease. And by the end of this presentation, 2 more people will have died because of it. My goal is to help creating effective mosquito traps so that one day we will see news like that all over our televisions, and it will finally be the end of people dying from a mosquito bite. Ultimately, the aim is to catch those bloodsuckers.
Thank you very much, Manuela, and thank you to all of our finalists. It's going to be really tough to choose a winner from all of those excellent performances. So whilst the judges deliberate, this is your opportunity to think about who you would like to win the People's Choice. On the right of your screens, you will see a vote icon just underneath the chat and info icons. Note that you can change your mind once the voting starts, but you can only cast your vote once. So let the voting begin for the Vitae 3-Minute Thesis 2021 People's Choice winner.
Managing to condense, firstly, my thoughts, which is tricky enough, but also a very complex subject matter down into 3 minutes. It's given me a wealth, breadth of skills, but I definitely found that the hardest. Getting it down from an hour to three was tricky.
I really felt that Theo did an excellent job of giving me, as the listener, a really good structure, but also language to understand how he is studying and working with the smell of cells. But also important about that is that he gave me the tools, the language, the structure, so that I can go and tell other people about what his research is about. And I think that is the sign of really good communication, that you've given me the tools so that I can actually go and retell your story for someone else and still be true to what you were sharing with me in the first instance. He did an excellent job of that.
Present in itself, for sure. I really enjoyed that. And I feel like every time I do the speech, I kind of go through it again. And it's the most enjoyable part, especially if you see people. I know that here I didn't see them, but like actually once when I did the video, my friends, they helped me to record it. And that was kind of very close to real.
Elena used analogies and phrases that were just beautiful. So although we're talking about brain science, she was comparing it to a city with a locked door and we're searching for a key. So the use of analogy was fantastic from Elena.
My top tip would be to make your script simple, to learn it thoroughly, to understand the thread of your story. I think simplicity is critical.
I think for me, Mohammed really exemplified the importance of practitioner research. He was so passionate and presented a real sort of vignette of the students that he works with and the challenges that they have and the life challenges they have. I felt that he was able to demonstrate the importance of contextual community-based research and the benefits of that in terms of life chances for the young people he works with. So huge amount of passion and enthusiasm.
I think for me, the most important skill was to try and simplify, but not oversimplify my research, if that makes sense, to make it accessible to other people. Because actually all of my family are engineers and so am I. So whenever I'm talking to someone in my close surrounding, they're all engineers. So for me, I don't really have this experience often trying to explain to someone else what I'm doing. Because, well, they normally say a cliche, imagine if you're explaining to your grandpa what are you doing? I would say, well, my grandpa is an engineer.
Well, Anna was talking about something that was really quite complicated and potentially quite dry as a topic. And so as well as conveying genuine enthusiasm for it, the use of the giraffe toy analogy was absolute genius for me. Devilishly simple, but really effective. What I also liked about Anna's presentation was how she clearly articulated the point of her research, which was to test out the robustness of this new material over time, which potentially has huge implications for the construction industry. So really well done.
Creating like devices for blind rock climbers to navigate during a climbing activity. So you could like select red holds and it'll tell you where the red holds are via this brain port. And so I quite like to do a big public engagement activity at a climbing center and get like a bunch of people to come in and just like have loads of fun, maybe some blind visually impaired charities to come and just like get some free climbing lessons, things like that. That'd be really cool.
The fact that Mike's work gives hope for those, for people who are living with a visual impairment, the fact that he gave a baseline beyond what already exists on using Braille or using dogs, and he's looking at new technologies to give this particular audience a different way of experiencing sight. And it is so, it's so timely because we're still going through the Olympic fever, and we had also Olympians who are visually impaired, and it's a way of showing, of extending a level of hope that they, in the next Olympics, we may have new technologies for experiencing sight while you're competing. So this is really timely.
The advantage of having it in Zoom is that you don't see the audience. And that is both an advantage and a disadvantage, because sometimes it's good to have the feedback from the audience, but some other time it's also just good to just do your thing, look at the camera, know that you're just talking with one person, as in like the camera, rather than seeing, I don't know, 600 people, which is terrifying.
So Manuela addressed a really big problem with so much passion and so much inspiration. And she made it really accessible for someone like me, including all the detailed findings in her project that really made it come to life.
I'm now joined by Caroline Sutton, Director of Open Research at Taylor & Francis, the main sponsors of today's competition. Hello, Caroline.
Hi, Chris. Nice to be here with you.
Thank you very much for joining us. And I'd like to start by asking you to tell us about the long-standing relationship Taylor & Francis have had with the 3-Minute Thesis competition and why you continue sponsoring the competition.
Oh, it is our pleasure and privilege to be a sponsor of this competition. Something that you'll hear many of my colleagues at Taylor & Francis say is that we champion the researcher. And we champion the researcher of today, but also the researchers of tomorrow, like we've heard from today. We feel this is really key. We are one of the world's leading publishers of scholarly books, journals, and other materials. And this is a part of what our role is. And combined with that is a second thing that you'll often hear me and other colleagues at Taylor & Francis say, and that is that one of the things that really drives us as individuals and as a company is that we're really key to understand and to help identify the real world impacts that research is going to have. And 3MT is obviously an excellent example of where we can support that. So thank you very much.
So we often think about researchers doing research, but can you tell us about the importance for these researchers in developing skills to communicate that research?
I'm sure everyone has recognized most recently in public debate, it really shows us why this is important, right? We see things around vaccines, around the pandemic, around global climate change, just to give a few examples of why it's really, really important that societies around the globe understand what researchers do and can actually understand what sources they can go to and look to truly understand how research is helping to change the world and what that means for their lives. So I'm really inspired to see the group that we saw today who are just so keenly engaged with communicating their research for others. And in particular, we saw examples of very complex research that many individuals might often think, oh, I wouldn't understand that, it would be over my head, but where, you know, the entries we saw today were really able to take these complex things and findings and bring them to life in a way that anyone could understand and understand the importance of. And I really appreciated that today.
Now, I certainly learned a lot by watching these presentations today. So, yeah, it's been great to speak to you, Caroline. Thank you so much for being a judge. And thanks also to Taylor & Francis for being our main sponsor.
On behalf of Taylor & Francis and all my colleagues, thank you for having us involved. It was a real pleasure, as always.
So I'm now joined by Dr. Steve Scott, Public Engagement Lead at UKRI. Welcome, Steve, and thank you for joining me for this chat.
Oh, you're welcome. It's nice to be here.
Brilliant. So can you tell us a bit about why UKRI supports the Vitae 3MT competition and how this fits with UKRI's strategic direction.
Yeah, so UKRI's vision is for an outstanding research and innovation system in the UK, and that's one that gives everyone the opportunity to contribute and to benefit. So to achieve this mission, research needs to actively involve a wide range of people with the differences in knowledge, experience, expertise, because that helps to generate new ideas and creative approaches to tackle some of those different challenges that we face, like climate change and COVID and lots of other things. But good, clear, concise communication is key to this. So it's important that researchers are encouraged and supported to develop the skills to communicate their research in clear and engaging ways to different groups. So being able to share your research with others in just 3 minutes is a great way of honing your communication skills. And that's why we support the 3-minute thesis.
So as public engagement lead at UKRI, what specific type of engagement activity would get you really excited?
Public engagement can take many different forms. So we've got public lectures on one hand, which is, you know, just about sharing research with people with enthusiasm. But you can take hands-on activities to science festivals, or even, you know, kind of be involved in small group discussions. And that's all great. That's what engagement is all about. It's about the fun stuff, but it's also about those important conversations that are vital to research. But the most important thing with any engagement activity is that it's got a clear purpose for, you know, doing that engagement, and that it brings in different perspectives. So with this, we're encouraging the winners to think about how they can engage groups of people with their research who maybe tend to be underrepresented or marginalised and don't have as many opportunities to engage or be involved in research as some other groups. So we want to see them go beyond those usual groups that they may previously have engaged with and reach out to new people, try something different, a little bit out of their comfort zone, and hopefully working with a group that they've not had a chance to work with before.
Yeah, democratising science capital is a really important thing and something I'm very passionate about. So thank you so much, Steve, for taking this time to talk to me today. And thank you to UKRI for supporting the Vitae 3MT competition with the prize money. So thank you again, Steve.
It's a pleasure. Thanks very much. Nice to meet you.
Thank you. And now, Claire Viney, CEO of the Careers Research and Advisory Centre and Vitae, is with me now. So hello, Claire.
Hi, Chris. How are you?
I'm very good. Can you tell us a little bit about Vitae's support of 3MT and what you believe its legacy is and what it probably will be in the future?
So we've been involved with 3-Minute Thesis for the last 7 years, and over 10,000 researchers have taken part. And the format really helps researchers think about how to communicate their research with a variety of different audiences, including the public. So really the legacy isn't just the number of researchers taking part, it's the way that they reflect on, the way that they develop their communication and presentation skills.
Brilliant. Thank you so much for your time, Claire, and thank you so much for your huge efforts in keeping this amazing competition going. So well done. Thank you so much.
And thank you to you, Chris. You've been phenomenal.
Thank you. So thank you again to our 6 finalists, the judges, sponsors, and last but not least, you, our audience, for tuning in to this year's exciting competition. We will be back shortly when the votes have been counted to reveal who will be the Vitae 3MT 2021 Judges' Choice and People's Choice winners. And we're back. Voting is now closed for the People's Choice winner. And before we announce who that is, I'm going to hand over to Caroline Sutton from Taylor & Francis to announce the Judges' Choice winner.
And the winner is Anna Pavlovich with pre-stress losses of pre-tensioned BFRP reinforced concrete beams. Congratulations, Anna.
So huge congratulations to Anna Pavlovich for being the Vitae 3MT 2021 Judges' Choice winner. Anna wins £3,000 to spend on a public engagement activity and a lovely engraved trophy. So well done, Anna.
Thank you very much. This was highly unexpected.
So would you like to say a few words about your stunning victory? Yeah, you've got to go ahead.
Yes, please. I would just like to thank everyone and congratulations to all the participants. Everyone was amazing. So thank you very much. This was highly unexpected for me. I haven't had any speech prepared. So thank you. That's all.
No, it was super. It was a brilliant presentation, Anna, and clearly the judges were completely taken by it. So congratulations again. Well done. Okay, so that was the judges' choice winner, Anna Pavlovich. And so the votes now have been counted, and I am pleased to announce that the Vitae 3NT People's Choice winner for 2021 is, drumroll, Manuela Kanagi from the University of Greenwich. With Houston, the mosquito has landed. Huge presentation. Well done, Manuela. You get to, you win £1,000 to spend on a public engagement activity and a fancy engraved trophy too. Would you like to say a few words?
Thank you so much. Honestly, as Anna said, all the other participants were great. And I am so, so happy. I'd like to thank all the people that supported me, guided me through this wonderful journey. And I just recommend this journey for all PhD students. Really do take this experience. It's great. It's fantastic. So thank you.
Absolutely brilliant. Well done, Manuela, again. And yeah, congratulations on your award. And congratulations to all of this year's finalists and everybody who took part in the 3MT competition this year under unusual circumstances. And so despite being another tough year for all of us, the calibre of the six finalists, as you've seen, has been and remained incredibly high from previous years. This has been the second virtual Vitae 3MT competition. And whilst there are challenges of presenting virtually, the competition clearly goes from strength to strength. Each and every quarter finalist, semi-finalist and finalist works really hard to hone their performance and bring us their awesome science in a compact form. And hopefully you saw that today. A massive congratulations again to you and to our judges' choice and people's choice winners of 2021. And I hope that you'll be able to use your excellent presenting skills and articulation of your research to help you develop your future careers and be part of a more open, responsible, and inclusive research culture. Thank you to our sponsors, Taylor & Francis and UKRI, the Vitae team and all those involved in coordinating and supporting the 61 institutions that entered, and to the 1,000 doctoral candidates who took part in their institutional competitions. It's just a phenomenal number of people, and the logistics required to support this is truly breathtaking. Thank you again to our judges, Jamie Gallagher, Siobhan Neary, Joy Owango, Paul Spencer, and Caroline Sutton, and in the chair, Astrid Wissenberg. And thank you again to our finalists, Theo, Elena, Mohammed, Anna, Mike, and Manuela. Absolutely superb performances from you all this year. And thank you as well to you, the audience who tuned in to watch, and also to the hundreds and hundreds of you, as I'm looking at we were communicating by WhatsApp what the voting was going around. There was hundreds and hundreds of people who registered to vote and who finally voted as well. And that's really, really impressive and testament to the draw of this competition. So if you have been inspired to be part of a 3MT competition, you can find out more information at www.vitae.ac.uk/3MT. So I'm Professor Christopher Jackson, and it's been an absolute pleasure hosting the 2021 Vitae 3MT competition. Thank you for tuning in, and goodbye.